everyone, and welcome back to another episode with the Nairobi Hospital. Today I'm joined by dietitian Dorcas Gichuhi. We're going to tackle a few issues in regards to nutrition, health, and general well-being in terms of your food. Welcome, Dorcas.
Thank you
for joining us today. This is actually my first time with a nutritionist.
Okay.
Just to start us off, what exactly does a nutritionist do?
Okay. Thank you so much for having me. I'm a dietitian. Yeah. Usually we will use dietitian and nutritionist interchangeably. Mm-hmm. When you come to a nutritionist, you'd have physical assessment, there's clinical assessment, and then you have biochemical assessment. Then that guides us into meal planning.
Within the past 10 years, would you say that there's been an increase in obesity or overweight?
Yeah.
Especially in the urban centers.
Yeah, there's a sharp rise, I would say that. Like recently when they did the survey, the health surveys that they do every 10 years, they noticed that in Nairobi alone as a city, we are at 41% in terms of overweight and obesity. So an overweight person would be having a BMI that is between 24.9 and 29.9. That's an overweight. And then when you have a BMI that would be above 29.9 or above 30, that's an obese criteria. Then each obese criteria has different classes. Yeah. And those different classes are what will determine, can you go into a weight loss with diet and lifestyle modification, or are you going to have some other interventions for that weight management?
Is there something I can do at home to say,
to
okay,
get your
I think
BMI?
I'm overweight. Yeah.
Uh-huh. I need to know first my height, and most of the people, we have a bathroom scale and we can get to have an actual weight early in the morning. And then you want to know your height. Usually, because you can't measure your height the way you're standing, you would take your arm and stretch it. Mm-hmm. So arm span halfway. So that same centimeter times two would be your height. Mm-hmm. So your BMI would be your weight in kilograms, and then you divide that with your height in meters squared. So what you get there is a ratio, and that's the ratio what you're doing as. Is it 24? Is it 23? Yeah, to get a normal BMI or an overweight or an obese BMI.
There's some people who are genetically bigger than others.
Yeah.
So to what extent does genetics versus lifestyle contribute to what we term as overweight or obese? Yeah.
So usually there's a very thin line between your genetics and your lifestyle. But usually the way you would want to determine, is it lifestyle, is it my genetics, you want to know what level of BMI are you at. If you go ahead and take what is your waist circumference, I think that's the main thing for this discussion. Yeah, that waist circumference will determine, is it lifestyle that is part of my weight problem, or is it my genetics that are affecting, or my genes that are affecting my weight gain kind of a process. So usually for all female, you want to take your waist circumference around your navel, and that you'll take it in centimeters. Yeah. So for female, you would have a cutoff of 88 centimeters. And for male, you would have a cutoff, like a maximum of 1 or 2 centimeters. So that waist circumference determines, is it a genetic kind of a problem, or is it a lifestyle kind of a problem? Because if your waist circumference is above normal, that's definitely a lifestyle that you want to work around.
Yeah. Okay, in so as much people as, have a larger circumference.
Yeah, you have a larger waist. Yeah, it is definitely lifestyle related. Mm-hmm. Now, biochemical are where you'd have lab reports done and maybe some samples taken to the lab, and one of those samples would measure your lipid profile. So most people who would have fat, let's say around your organ, that would be cholesterol. And lipid profile also has the cutoff points. If you have that done in the lab, they will tell you, are you within normal ranges of cholesterol, and we have different types of cholesterol. In as much as you want to look at the physical BMI, BMI in itself is not a very good factor to just determine, am I overweight, or do I need to do some changes with my diet? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What can you give us as an overview in terms of the changes that you see we need to make as Nairobians?
So usually for every person to remain within the healthy kind of a framework, you would need to have 3 meals. And the definition of every meal is to have the balance. Yes. So you're looking for such a balance, yeah? Mm-hmm. So usually for how we serve is a factor, because I could have this kind of a plate, but then how are my portions in terms of what I have served, yeah? Mm-hmm. So one of the portions here is a carbohydrate, and this is chicken, this is protein, and then we have the vegetable double portion. Mm. So this kind of plating into your meals would be a very good effective way to control how much you're going to snack in between in the course of your day. You have calorie from the starch, calorie from the protein and calories from vegetables. So when you have this kind of a balance, you're not able to have as much of starch, and this is what you store when you take in excess.
This is the carbohydrate?
Yeah, so usually would use a feast also if you want to be very exact. So a visual aid would help. So usually it's a feast of starch. So that would be like that much of your starch. Yeah. For your protein, you'd use this part of your palm, yeah? And then you'd have like a double portion of vegetable.
Would you say that there's some foods that help you stay fuller for longer? How do we curb hunger and stop the snacking?
In between?
Yes.
As part of your snack, you need to carry your lunch. That's like a golden rule, and it really works, yeah? Because you don't have time to want to go and look for lunch outside or different places where they're doing meals, yeah? So once you pack your lunch, you're able to portion the food as you would want. The other thing is we also encourage people to carry some bitings of vegetable. And they could be carrot sticks or cucumber slices. They could be some diced lettuce, things that also don't ferment, maybe, yeah, as you store them longer. So there are things that you can reach to your desk and just bite, yeah. So that it keeps you going and it fuels you. It gives you that satiety you're looking for, and it doesn't give you any calorie.
Yeah? Okay. So what would you say are the must-haves and maybe the no-nos?
Portion really works. You know, like every portion of sugar and fat, because those are things that you don't need as much because their calorie is part of your starch. So usually when you want to serve such kind of, let's say sugar or fat, you would have such a teaspoon, you see. Like I want to have my cup of tea with sugar. So a teaspoon of sugar is an allowance, you know. The teaspoon should not heap. You don't heap the quantity, the teaspoon. So it's a level teaspoon. If you want to do the same for fat, it would be a level, maybe butter or peanut butter, that kind of fat. So you also want to choose healthy kind of fats because you have healthy and very saturated fats. Yeah. So once you choose a healthier option, you can comfortably portion it into a convenient quantity that will not give you as much of calorie. It will be negligible calorie part of your day.
But Dorcas, you know, a lot of these foods, we don't go and pick fat and portion it.
Yes.
The fat is in the process
in
of
the cooking.
Because I go home, if I'm not the one cooking, I find the food has
already been done.
So how do I influence that
kind of process?
That kind of, yeah.
So what we want to look for here is only one item on that plate should be fried. That's another principle. Yeah. So if it's pilau, remember it is a starch. You can't say pilau has beef. And still portion much more of it because it's still a carb. But then your vegetable here could only be either steamed or vegetable salad. And you'll find most of the pilau joints will actually serve salad with pilau.
Yeah.
So you could saute your vegetable here, but you've grilled here, you see. And then your starch just remains, either it's a boiled mashed potato or it will be the same ugali and that kind of flow. Now there's another concept of grilled red meat, you see. You want to make sure that what you have as red meat is either a stew or a boil. However, I can only grill chicken or fish. That's my white meat. I can grill that and I can comfortably have it.
Do you really think that we need 3 square meals a day, or that's you can do well with 2?
What happens with intermittent fasting, that's very encouraged, because usually it's just the term intermittent. You're doing it for a short period of time and then you'll continue with your lifestyle as it were, maybe. Yeah? If I'm doing that fasting and it is consistent as part of my lifestyle, it would work very well. But if I go back to my lifestyle, my meals would have to be 3 concrete meals. Now the other diets where we're having a very quick diet that is a smoothie or it's a detox or it is a combination of maybe no starch kind of, where you're avoiding your carbohydrate. Yeah? The problem with those is that you cannot do them for so long into a period and not resume to your usual. Usually we have that usual kind of eating habits. Yeah? So it's a quick fix, but then eventually you go back to your normal lifestyle. You get back the weight, because usually once you start eating, you would have to, your body would automatically gain the weight back. So you're going back and forth. There's also risk in going back and forth because you risk reducing your immunity. Your immunity is very much affected because at that point where you're not eating much, you're not getting the nutrition that you require. For most of the ladies, we risk hormonal imbalances. So you end up people having problems with their menstruation. You're not getting your period as it were. You get to gain weight unintentionally. I'm just seated, I'm not eating much, but I'm putting on some bit of weight. Yeah. Workout doesn't have to be every day I'm going to the gym. It could be maybe 2 times in a week. What you're looking for is the time that you get. If you can't get an hour or more than an hour for a workout, then you need to do your exercise every day.
So what if I just say, you know, I can't live a life of restriction.
Mm-hmm.
I want to eat how I want to eat, mm-hmm. and I'll train 7 days a week.
So every day I'm going to do my workout?
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Usually my body would lose, okay, my exercises are part of calorie burning,
mm-hmm.
yeah? But my exercises are not, they will not give you the fiber that you get, you want to get. They will not give you that quality protein that you want to get from the meals that you're having. So usually it's also wellness. In as much as you're thinking about weight loss, it's also wellness as a person. And that wellness has to be part of it as
nutrition.
A diet. Yeah, it has to be part of it as nutrition.
So another thing I want us to talk about is fruits. Mm-hmm. I know people say fruits are healthy, but they're also sugars.
They are also sugars.
I know there's unhealthy sugars and healthy sugars.
Yes.
What are you seeing in terms of how we're consuming sugars and fruits specifically?
Yeah. Usually one of the things that we find at the clinic, fruits, because you have that notion that fruits are very good. Most people would want to have it into a salad, so you'd plate it into like such a platter of fruits,
mm.
and there are different fruits into that kind of a portion. So this is like an orange, this is kiwi, and these are berries. Every single of these fruit that is the size of your fist is the same sugar or the same carbohydrate as that ugali.
Uh-huh.
You see?
Yeah.
So usually once you plate as many fruits into your platter as most of the time we will do, you end up recompensating your calorie. So you're doing a weight loss, you're reducing calorie, but then you have recompensated it all the way. So one of the best ways to do your fruit is have one single fruit at a time,
mm.
and don't have the two fruits together. So you can't say like half an orange and one apple.
So fruit salad, no.
So fruit salad, unless the quantity is the size of such a bowl, maybe, that kind of a bowl.
A small quantity
usually is a handful. That could be a fruit salad, equivalent to one orange or one apple in terms of calorie. Now, if I want to have the same fruit as a juice, so I have these two types of glasses. Usually I like using this. It's a very tiny glass, yeah?
Mm.
But hardly we have this kind of juice.
Mm.
And because usually we can't even get this from, we don't have them in the house, as the half cup, half glass of juice, yeah? So the best way to do your fruit is not to juice it, because this much of juice is the same as that part, one fruit. So if I have double my glass here, of juice, like what maybe I would get from where? Java,
mm-hmm.
you see, like a smoothie. Usually the calorie is so much into that much of juice or a smoothie or a shake. So it's not something you want to do more frequently as part of your lifestyle, you see? Yeah. However, if it is this much of juice, you could do it. But the best way is to have one single fruit every time you want to have the fruit, so that you're still within the limits of a controlled portion of your fruit intake.
All right, thank you so much for taking us through this very interesting topic.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah. Right. Thank you so much for having me also. I think it's something that we would want to keep doing so that most people are able to learn exactly what's the best way to do things. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Nice meeting you.